I gotta thumb that camera. Hey, it's got a little tilt to it. Reminds me of a 1950s special kind of. They had these little chairs to sat in that used to go round and round and round again. It's called Tilt-A-Whirl. Hey, we're on a free Tilt-A-Whirl ride right here on planet Earth. We are moving at such velocity. We call ourselves Velo City. I'll be on bicycles and go a couple of trillion miles per hour. Okay. A Tapestry of Then and Now, 1986, Brisbane, Australia. F11, get a full screen. Along the slender passages of time, besplendored rope of habits and of customs, we weave a thing called hope. And there the tapestry began to tell a lovely tale of men and women's bravery when love was not for sale. Hey, when was that? It was like, okay, stay with the poem here. Okay. But now the brims, they overflow on the schooners of the rich, who brag about their poverty, while others they bewitch to get a thing called cash flow from sorcerers of theft. More money for less product is what buys them their respect. The dainty and the delicate ensnare the seeing blind when confronted with the facts and truth. They just say, never mind, no thanks, say they. No thanks, triumphantly. Destruction's road they take. After all, it's called prosperity. Yeah, with chaos in its wake. Yep. Now, along the slender passages of time, besplendored rope. You know, I was, what do we call it now? I was working at the airport there, down underneath the airport, in these little concrete areas. Working. Yeah, a late shift on this thing. I was encoding. There was an array of special types of receptive cameras, and there was several arrays. And the suitcases, would, after they got X-rayed by TSA, no, not T.S. Eliot, TSA, it's like Transport Security Authority or something like that. I'll never forget, man, when I was traveling back in the 80s and the 70s, they used to have these people that were hired, you know, like off the street to, you know, it was like a junk job, you know, it's like minimum wage and everything, I guess. And I thought, oh my God, it'd be so easy for people to get through this thing. And, okay, and a couple of buildings collapsed later. Now we got the transport, the Transit Security Authority, or whatever it is, TSA. And you got to take off your shoes. Somebody might catch you lighting your shoes or something when it's too late. Or, and they got an x-ray. And I was helping the TSA. I was, on the Alaska Airlines side of the three huge TSA, they finally found out that my best job was, I was doing okay loading the belts for the TSA because I understood about ratio and paradox. And what happens is the belt, this huge belt that was like, it's like 100 yards long or something like that. It wasn't a belt, it was a carousel, extra large, big carousel. The chute would dump out these things from the ticket windows or from the check-ins, and sometimes you got a chicken that was from Kentucky Fried check-in. No, only kidding. And, sometimes a pizza, and that was the no-belt pizza prize. Anyway, so, and not only that, but I had done 5 paintings of this stuff 20 years earlier in Caracas, Venezuela. So, I knew the whole drill. Kind of like had this ethereal type of view of it. That's what I call it. I call that esotericing out. Esoteric. Because all of a sudden, you go from the ethereal down to, whoa, this is not a lady on a nude bather on a rock in this huge vaulted grotto, like 200 feet tall grotto of pure lapis lazuli lit up by indirect sunlight coming through. And I found out, yeah, they do have stuff like that in the Andes Mountains. Whoa, man, I'd love to see that, along with the Atlas mountain chain, the Mountains of the Moon. I think it's called the Valley of the Moon, where the azalea plants are as big as huge trees. Man, I'm on the must-see list. I don't know. The huge pine forests of Siberia, which probably don't exist anymore. They probably all got felled by the Jolly Good Feller scenario, along with the boreal forest of Canada. But anyway, just like giant tigers walking through there. The Mongolians call them wamba, I think. Anyway, wow. This is some planet we're on, guys. Anyway, so we're loading this up, and that was not, instead of lady on the, a nude on the rock, turns out to be, the TSA guy said, look, Paul, go ahead, help yourself to the water, you're doing a good job out here. So, I'd go in, I'd lean on the, fill up my water bottle, I'm leaning on the thing, put in my Gatorade, powdered Gatorade, make it stronger than the stuff you buy in the ready-made, and I'm looking in the bottle. It's a blue bottle, upside down. It has a little stopper in it, a little stopper. And when you turn the bottle upside down, then you put it on, the little spigot spout inside the mechanism pierces through the stopper. So a little plastic stopper then floats in the upside-down bottle. That's what I saw 20 years earlier, and I did a painting of it. It's called the blue visions of the blue forest of lapis lazuli. I guess it's called lazuli. I don't know. And nobody ever pronounces it as, lapis lazuli. They used to use it as the blue pigment for very valuable paintings. Like it was the name ultramarine blue to begin with. They use it like in the pictures of the Madonna. Her blue robes would be lapis lazuli paint. Duck, honey. Let's see. She's shy. I don't blame her. So anyway, it was just this little stopple floating around in the water bottle that I saw 20 years earlier. Why was that? It's just so important. Why? Hey, man, there's a lot of stuff we just don't understand. I did a drawing of the emergency stop button. I only used it once. That's when the suitcase got snagged as it went around. You know, I pressed that emergency stop button to stop the whole carousel. That was the most realistic one drawing I did. I closed my eyes in that Caracas hotel and I could see that thing. So anyway, so, you know, then later on, they, you know, so what happens is I understood ratios. So the thing that was actually jamming the carousel wasn't the biggest suitcases. The human thought says, get those big guys out of there first. We'll deal with the rest later. But it wasn't the big suitcases. It was those little suitcases. Because there was like... two-thirds of them were the actual small suitcases that are almost like carry-on size. A lot of people didn't want to mess around with a lot of luggage. They just take that as their suitcase, or two of those. And I do all of those first. So what happened was the managers saw it and thought that I was trying to, because I used to be able to get the biggest suitcase. This guy, 60 years old at that time, with huge suitcases, you know. Because half the lifting is done with your right here in your mind. You do the body physical lifting as like almost an after event. If you concentrate on how you move things, you can move these huge objects, you know. And they thought it was like this huge muscle man, and how could this skinny guy do that? But then I found out I could free the whole belt, I mean the whole carousel. And what I would do is, I'd pull off those little suitcases. I mean, in the final analysis, it turned out I was the only guy who could pull it off. So I pull off all those little suitcases, line them up in front of my belt. Now the TSA belt would stop, the big suitcase would get analyzed, and then they started again. But with the little suitcases, if you space them, I would line them up on the belt and push them on, and they spaced about 3 feet apart. The belt would move through continuously. And before long, everything was clear. Then you get the big stuff off. So the people with the big suitcase, you know, they got their stuff out there. So anyway, the management decided that I had changed from being a superhuman, huge suitcase lifter to a guy that's chickened out and only wanted to get the small suitcases. So they got the overachiever to the one spot. They said, listen, Paul, come on over here, and when those suitcases come down, line them up. Okay? That was considered the junk job. Nobody wanted to do that. It was like, almost like, they would sit there and watch the suitcases bounce off the edge. But what I did was, I began to see suitcases handle up, straight down, and the suitcases would come out faster than you could line them up. So it seemed. But if you used karate, you could, you know, like Bruce Lee's Kung Fu, but this is karate. Because karate, I was trained by this Japanese level five black belt. I was back in the YMCA. Young man, I hit the YMCA, I want to tell you, wanna move those suitcases, go to the YMCA, but you better go in 1965 when they have this five-level black belt up there in the gym with a free karate class. And I was only there for 2 weeks, but that was enough for me to learn a certain essence of karate, which I used then to gather shopping carts at Walmart. And a shopping cart on a hill. On a hill. With shopping carts at the market. Anyway, so, and Ah, man, I did some science on that. I found out exactly how much energy was needed to take up 20 shopping carts up the hill on a regular basis. And therefore, I was able to conclude that I had to have 3,000 calories a day, the amount of time, like I had a 15-minute break. How could I purchase a calorie supplement in a 15-minute break? All right, I'd go to the snack department because that would be before the supermarket there. You know, Super Walmart. So anyway, I went to the snack department and got me a pack of Little Debbie Swiss rolls, chocolate-covered Swiss rolls. I would make my purchase, be in the back room, and eat that whole box of Swiss rolls down. I'd get 1,500 calories, and that worked. I'll tell you, but I had a lot of chubby ladies getting mad at me. They would get so mad to see me sit there and eat a whole box of Debbie Swiss rolls. I'd say, well, I'm just a Swiss yodeler. I'd knock down one of those, and I'd go, yodeler, hoo-hoo. And go, yeah. You know, that's like, in your face, babe, watch this one.
Oh, how could he do that? Yes.
You know, I'd say, hey, baby, I'm here. You don't have to be hanging around watching this. You know, these people have this attitude. I have a terrible time with folks. But I have a way around that. I can make myself indispensable. Okay. Anyway, it's a long story. Francis Scott Key, we need you down here to write on the cuff and make me a long story shirt. So what happened was that I got this, you know, 200 carts an hour using karate. Yes, indeed. The principles of karate. Karate, as you say, you know, that was taught to me by the Japanese sensei. You know, pardon the accent. So, I mean, at one point, I wasn't really surprised when a black belt lady, a lady with a black belt, came up deliberately and talked to me and commended me for my use of karate, which was an honor because, of course, it was like folk karate, you know. It's like no serious training. But it worked, man. It worked. And so I used this karate and also the... I'll tell you that shoot spit out those suitcases. They were coming at me, man. They were coming at me. First thing is calm. Second thing, lean into it. Third thing, move carefully. Everything's a key move. I used to have spectators. People would come over to watch me do it. Like that, and the suitcases were lined perfectly. They'd come in and total chaos. Line them perfectly. Every now and then I'd miss a few, but then, you see, every day you did that, the better you get. And they used to watch me and just wonder how the heck I could do that. One time, I learned to flip these small suitcases up, so they'd flip in the air, and a suitcase fought back. You know, the extendable handle that they have to pull them on the wheels? This one lost its ability to hold it in, and the centrifugal force of the spin, I had it so that I would give it the flip, and it would spin in midair and land upright. But as it did, the centrifugal force extended the handle, and it hit me upside the face. And you know when they say something like, the industry got a black eye, you're not kidding. When I walked around with a black eye and just tried to tell people I got hit by the handle of a suitcase across my face, they wouldn't believe me. They thought I had lost a fist fight. And not only that, management was beginning to look at me like I had gone against their rules of no fighting while on the job or even off the job. oh, he's a violent guy. We knew it all along. Look at that. No, I got hit by a suitcase. No way. You're not going to tell him. There's something wrong with the human mind, I tell you. It's deteriorated. People have allowed that to happen, not only to themselves, but to their children. You get your little kid. Man, you don't give that kid quality time, he's going to lose his mind. Now, I can tell you because, I mean, the reason why I have any kind of semblance of a mind right now, and you can arguably, yeah, it can't do certain things, but certain things are a piece of cake, is that my mother took care of me, really gave me quality time when I was a kid, made sure I had input, made sure I you know. And then later on, of course, with that brain, I was into science like age 6 and 7. She got me my first microscope when I was, 7 years old. You know, stuff like that. Okay, so now we're dealing with this. So I just forgot everything why I was talking about this. Let's read this poem again. You don't mind if I go through this again real quick? Oh yeah, now I remember. Okay, so here's what happened. I got they sent me upstairs to encoding. I was really filling in for this guy while he went to the bathroom, and then it turns out that I was good at it. There was just some things at the airport I happened to be good at, like overachiever no longer interfered with it. One of them was, transfer runner. I would transfer those suitcases from like about 5 jets to about 5 or 6 other places, and they had to be there on time, you know. And oh man, you had to put your suitcase, you had to know where what was going where. It's like out there in the workforce, you're overqualified, you begin to get an inferiority complex. I mean, here are these guys supposedly, according to the test takers, you know, they have less IQ than you, and they're running rings around you in performance. Well, all of a sudden, this is something I could do. This is something I could do well. Wow. And then encoding. The only thing is then my disabilities kicked in whenever they got winter. When the winter set in and they had to defrost the, put the defrost on the, you know, what you call it, on the, I used to know what it was, but I'm starting to lose, you know, my ability to remember things. And they de-iced the wings, and the delay would, you'd have to have a whole new way of slotting those suitcases. Because of the delay, the suitcase would have to swing around. If they swung around on that thing, the weight would stop the belt. So once you stopped the belt, that was a disaster. All your suitcases would be late. Poor Alaska Airline folks would have to pay a huge fine on each late suitcase, you know, because of the, you know, situation. So, oh man, it was a big can of worms. So you didn't want that belt to stop. You had to keep the weight low on that belt, going to 17 bays. Now, beyond that, I can't tell you very much because you're not supposed to spill the beans on how things are set up. Yeah. Okay, so anyway, well, I'm up there, and I did, you know, I said, well, I don't see any paintings, Caracas paintings around here. I'm looking down the distance, like, it's about 150 feet to 200 feet of belt going down there, 2 belts, and no suitcases. I'm looking around. Wait a minute. Here's a painting that I did 40 years ago. And, oh, here's a little statue I made. The paint dripping on the wall is the same shape as this statue. I made this little statuette called the Whoopee Machine which had a section that pulled out of it called the ply philo latch board. I said, oh my God, it's the ply philo latch board in splattered paint on the wall. In fact, they even had, I did a one rendition of it by taking the latch board out, which I called the latch board, and put it on the surface of the painting and then sprayed black spray paint over it. And it came out as spatters. And the spatters were on the wall, too. It's like, we're in this time envelope. It's fabulous. But anyway, we had a little coffee maker there. And I was doing fine as long as I had my vitamin X, man. It was called X en Provence. And, man, was I having a good time. People used to get scared because I worked with these robots. They had robots that were actually really scary. And, you know, a robot doesn't look like... Well, the painting I did actually was a robot, but that's because I saw it in a dream. It was a painting of a dream, and there was a sticker with my little robot on it. And actually, I've got this on camera. It's hard as heck to document these, what I call premonitions. But anyway, but these the suitcase robots were like big cushions that at the right bay they go like that, and they gently take this suitcase without breaking anything and put it on the belt, go back before anything else could get in the way. It made this huge noise. One guy, he said, oh man, I'd love to have one of those in a prize ring. You could knock out the opponent and just like that. You know? So anyway, what happened is me and the robots working together, I was leaning over there. It's like, oh man, this is video game city. The last video game I was in was Stargate. When I was walking home, there was a Stargate machine there, and I used to toss in a couple of, you know, 10 cent pieces. You know, I guess there were 20 cent pieces there, and that Stargate machine on the way home. You know, I was walking my 10 miles. To another place where I got a premonition that was Mount Roskill from the center of Auckland back in 1985. But anyway, so I was a Stargate guy, you know. It's like Space Invaders, only it goes laterally, you know. So what happens is I had my scanner and I was down there leaning over the suitcases, and I'd get them, and the robot would scare the hell out of the people that were working on the bays. The robot would fill this huge, like 50-foot belt, double-layer belt, with suitcases, you know. And the robot went as fast as you encoded it. So the guy'd be sitting there, pshoom, pshoom. Like that, I tell you. Next thing you know, the whole belt's full. It was really cool. I don't think anybody ever did that except my the head of the head overseer. She was about that fast before, so people wanted to replace me, but the manager would say to them, you know, so why can't I do what Paul's doing? I said, you're not fast enough. Well, once again, part of it is the concept that the Oriental folks got of, karate. Anyway, so I would go through there to the bathroom. I'd say, okay, I got to go to the bathroom because, you know, and they used to get really mad. It's like, the guy sitting next to me. What are you doing? You just go to the bathroom too much. You know, that's one problem with coffee. It's like a diuretic, you know. Anyway, so just to fit this in, while I was there, I wrote a book during the time when we were waiting for the suitcases. That probably was what that was about. I'm not sure, but it was also, a lot of this was about the time of terrorism. You know, like I envisioned the collapse of the Twin Towers before they were built. I envisioned this TSA thing, in a way, before it happened. So, what can I tell you? There's something very important about it. Probably everybody's getting this, and just a couple of artists pick up on it and do some drawings, you know? This isn't me walking on some kind of pathway of gold through space. It's the guy down at the next X-ray unit standing beside the carousel, because that's tilted. Oh, okay, so... But when I was going to the bathroom, there was just like this wide of concrete, and that was your pathway to this one-seat bathroom. And every time I went through there, I would sing that song, because it's put to music. Along the slender... It's kind of like... who was that guy who... Roy Orbison. That type of... It's kind of a Roy Orbison type of... Along the slender passages of time besplendored rope. And so I think of that. Of habits and of customs, we weave a thing called hope. So anyway, so yeah, it's a kind of a Roy Orbison type, almost falsetto type, high pitch, high vibrato type song, you know. Pretty woman walking down the street along the slender passages. You imagine if all of a sudden was into protest, you know. Anyway, so, okay, along the slender passages I would go to the bathroom and think of that song. I thought of that so much. Then I was also thinking about, I might as well cover that here. I wanted to write a book about it called, was it Odd Seven or something? Let's see, it was like, I forgot the title now. There was even an odd, it's like, and so anyway, I can't remember, so there's no time for the 20-second lapse and when it takes me to remember. I'll probably catch it later, but there's a couple of things about the airport. One of these had two towers. It had an old tower and a brand new tower that they had built, quote, brand new, maybe about 10 years old or something. State of the art. Okay, the old tower was right in the crux of the airport. The new tower was at a distance away, and it reminded me of Tolkien's The Lord of the Rings, the two towers, right? The two towers. And another thing that reminded me was really got me was the story of H.G. Wells' story, The Time Machine. When he was there with the time traveler went as far ahead as he could, and he found that there was humanity had split up into two. One of them was the Eloi, and the other was the Morlocks. And the Morlocks were these guys who lived underground with machinery all the time. And man, I was underground with the machinery going all the time. And we'd work so long, 12 hours a day, just like time melted away, and it became like your clothes would almost fall apart on you. I began to use like stuff that I would find abandoned on the runway. You know, like a guy would leave his big sweatshirt there and probably go on to another job eons ago, and I'd pull it out, bleach it, wash it. That was my new uniform. Long sleeve t-shirt, it's like rags, holes begin to show up. I come out for a break and go out and get myself an espresso at the man, I'm forgetting everything. I thought I'd never forget the name of that coffee place. It was like Coffee Girl or something like that. It's just like, it was a fabulous name. They had a decent espresso. I'd sit there and stare at this work of art that was done with reflector. Anyway. And I'd be there in rags, man. I'd be there in my rags. And I'd come out with these passengers going in like they were almost like the Eloi called in. And I was like the Morlock coming out from below, going out there in rags. It was so weird. It's like if I would choose who I would be the time traveler. And guess what? It turned out I was the time traveler. I had done a painting of the robot on the sticker next to where I worked 40 years earlier. And that was from a dream. Talk about time travel. You got it, baby, right outside here on the wall. The White Knight. I had done a painting of that in gouache back in 1965 in New York City. Never saw this place. I did three paintings of this of San Juan here. It's like, what the heck? I did a painting of the twin towers of the post office down here. They aren't really those small towers, but that was built in the 30s. And I did it. I did the painting of them in the 60s, and then in the 09 of the 20th century, there I am looking out the broken window of this cheap hotel room, and I see the Twin Towers, the post office. I didn't even know what the heck that was in the painting. I look over there, and I look over there. That's familiar, especially with that steam coming out of there. OMG moment. That was, I thought, I'm sitting in Oakland, California in 1970, in a cheap apartment just across the street from Black Panther headquarters. And, man, I thought I was doing a picture of a castle on the Rhine. Nope, it was the Bacardi Rum Distillery. And then the other one, I did a painting of this... I'm going out with this paintbrush in my hand. I'm a blue figure. And it looks like rainbows. And this tower in the back in these... It turns out to be a picture from of the rooftops with the tower... the tower of the Banco Popular down there in Old San Juan. And there was like the spattered reproduction of my Philo lashboard on the wall. I started looking around for other stuff, but anyway. Yeah, you can see a video of it. It's let's see. I did a cover of Early Morning Rain. You know, oh man. In the early morning rain, with no place to go, something like that. You got it. I mean, that's a whole different thing. But anyway, you can't catch an old jet plane. plane, like you can an old freight train. I'm going to tell you how to do it, Gordo. And hey, as if I knew, but you do your painting. You do your future painting. You travel through time. You catch that plane just like a rhyme. And Gordo caught his planes too that way. Write the song first. Anyway, so I'm going through there along the slender passages, and I'm going through there because it's such a horrible, impoverished environment. With the human beings working in there, the place turns black, you know. And that was my hypothesis about a health problem there, because people were getting very sick all the time. And it was probably because you had a lot of, what do you call that? Dangerous microbes in that black level. That it builds up in every industrial area. You know, it's like in a normal ecosystem, you have that's part of the saprobic chain, but you normally have things to take care of that. And by the way, you get stuff like that in old growth forests, and we have yet to do the science on that. We don't have time to go into that. So you see what you can get out of the poem. So there is 1986 Brisbane, perhaps. I was working on that. Slender passages. I'd sing that song every time I walked to the bathroom. So let's go over that again here. Along the slender passages of time, besplendored rope of habits and of customs, we weave a thing called hope. And there the tapestry began to tell a lovely tale of men and women's bravery when love was not for sale. But now the brims, they overflow on the schooners of the rich, who brag about their poverty while others they bewitch to get a thing called cash flow from sorcerers of theft. More money for less product is what buys them their respect. Where? Why, it's got to be the street, man. They aren't looking for the bottom line. You got to get your respect, man. Huh? You got your cattle out there, these huge cattle mills, almost neck deep in their own manure. Wondering why people are getting E. coli in their hamburgers. It's just like out of touch, man. They're looking for the respect from the street, dictating the beat for the neat of the cleat. And the befuddled elite, you know. Okay. But now the brims, they overflow on the schooners of the rich who brag about their poverty. That's not real poverty. They're saying, oh, we can't make it. We got to be conservative, I tell you. While others, they bewitch to get a thing called cash flow from sorcerers of theft. And it's like, you get cash flow from an economic engine. Oh, no, no, they got to get sorcerers of theft. What happens there, man? Well, the epitome of sorcerers is they're totally incompetent. Sorcier waiting by the source of the, or the spring, you know. Girl by the whirlpool, as Bob Dylan would say, the girl by the whirlpool is looking for a new fool. Don't follow leaders. Watch your parking meters, you know. So what did the sorcerers of theft tell them? Industrial, military industrial complex to tie in to the industry of death and get yourself a nice, like, unwinnable war somewhere far away from your home as possible. And by then you're going to be rich. And what happens is you say, peace, boys, peace. The war's over. You're fired. We'll lay you off. Here's your pink slip. And then what happens is they say, well, where are we going to go? And it's like, hey, boys, how about buying one of my, products? I mean, especially this stuff is like, what do you call it? Durable goods. Man, we can't afford it. We don't have any money. And, whoa, I'll have to go out of business too. Yeah, but, you know, the guys with their sorcerers of theft, now all of a sudden they got more money from the war, and then you know, it even becomes more money than that because it's worth more when nobody else has it, right? It's there in the poem, man. But now the brims, they overflow on the schooners of the rich, who brag about their poverty, while others they bewitch to get a thing called cash flow from sorcerers of theft. Hey, this stuff really goes on, man. More money for less product is what buys them their respect. No, detect the note of disdain in my voice. The dainty and the delicate ensnare the seeing blind. When confronted with the facts and truth, they just say, never mind. No thanks, say they triumphantly. Destruction's road they take. After all, it's called prosperity. With chaos in its wake. It's like, yeah, man. You check it out in history. These people, that's nothing new. This is a quirk of human nature. They're repeating history, man. And then what happens then is like social upheaval, chaos, like you never believed. In this case, you got yourself a nuclear exchange going on somewhere down the road with the United States getting nuked. Tell me. I hope it's not going to happen, buddy. But, you know, somebody's got to do a lot of 180s around. I don't see that happening, boy. They want the dainty. They want the delicacy. They can see, but they can't see it coming. They can't see what hit them. They're confronted with data. They're confronted with the news. They're confronted with the abuse. They're getting what they choose. But they just say, never mind. Never mind. No, thank you. No, thank you. I used to say, it's like, in England, hey, my underground journal, come on, man, read it now. No, Hanks. No, Hanks. It got to be Hanks instead of thanks. Hanks. And then, in France, merci, merci. Merci. Non, merci. Non, merci. It's like, merci. You know? Or it's like, forget the United States. I remember the time I went down to the World Trade Center and tried to get out this little underground newspaper on economics entitled Doom, right? Huh? And you should have seen the attitude that I copped on that one, man. Unbelievable. You should have seen the attitude that the people were unloading on me. Like I was the worst low of the low, totally ignored. And, you know, hey, it's like, that's 80, 90, 2001. It's like 30 years later. Tell me what that's all about, man. Did I see it coming? I don't know. It's like, not that much. I'm not a fortune teller. I mean, I can see the future, but I think everybody else can too. Except some people. Hey, I don't know if I'm next. I shut my mouth, I'll tell you. But the thing is, like, They had it dainty. They had it delicate. They had the cash flow. They had the generated. They found the bedrock of granite, and they built that tall structure. They piled the clientes, los clientes, one on top of the other. On and on they went. And, you know, I was passing this sticker on a car up the street, and it said, 9/11 was an inside job. Well, if it was, then who the heck got destroyed on that day? Maybe the wait staff, huh? I mean, was it expendable? I can tell you one thing I do know. They had a contingency of the FBI they were headquarters in the World Trade Center for the security against terrorism for New York City. That was their, apparently, their designation. And man, I heard this one report. I think it was on NBC or something. Every last one of them was out in California for training exercise. Well, you know, it's like Murphy's Law. The minute you go on a training exercise, the tower collapses. Well, the only difference is this was every last one of them. And nobody in their right mind would send the whole contingency to be trained. You know, if they do, they need to fire those people. It's like, what is that, an investigatory old folks home? Get them a rocking chair and let them do some knitting? Okay, so they had it dainty. They had it delicate. But they ain't even going to listen to me. That was hard for me to do, man. I had to ride the dog. I covered 50,000 miles in one summer, in 4 months, including the month of May, where I almost got my death of bronchitis or whatever it was. You know, before I could afford the dog, a greyhound bus, the dog. I was sleeping under bridges, man. I'd have these dreams of trucks rolling over my head. Because, you know, these semis would just be that far above me. Boom, boom. You ever got so tired that you fell asleep with that happening right over your head at the same time? You know, the noise wouldn't even wake you up. At one time, I was sleeping under there, one bridge in a place where you're not really, they frown so bad on hitchhiking. I used to dread having to hitchhike through this place. It was Virginia, you know, and I was stuck outside of Richmond. And I slept under a bridge. I got up the next morning and I had my poncho on, very thin poncho. It looked almost like Batman. It was made of this material that was kind of like nylon, you know. And I was like in my 30s then, or 40s, whatever. You know, I jumped up on the railing, stood on the railing of the bridge, jumped off and whew, landed on, you know, whew, on the ground, on the sidewalk, and my little black poncho flapping down, looking like something out of a Batman movie, right next to a patrol car. And officer, if you're watching it to this day, this is what really happened. He looks around. He just looked around and saw me when I was coming down. He didn't see me, like, balancing on the railing there, clambering over the from underneath the bridge. All he saw was me landing on my feet with this cape flapping, and he said, "Where did you come from?" You know, it has like where they smile with their mouth, but their eyes are. And his eyes were not like that. His eyes were like, "Uh oh. You have entered the Twilight Zone." I said, no, I'm human. No, you're a UFO, aren't you? I said, no, I'm human. Here, look, I got my passport. Run the check, Paul Hall. Yeah, you check out, but passport back. I know what you really are. You're from outer space, aren't you? I thought, oh my. I said, look, just don't tell anybody. I got to get going. He says, well, that's okay. You can go out and hitchhike on the highway. Just go right to the highway. This is the only one of two times where the policeman said it was okay to hitch on the limited access carriageway. The other time was in another place where they frown on hitchhikers. There were stories about Arizona. If you got stuck in Arizona, man, chances are you could end up in jail for vagrancy back in like 1970. And I was down there hitchhiking through Arizona with Deal and Oros and Kay Bradner's brother, and we slept overnight, and we were out there at this at the entrance, you know, hitchhiking the entrance, and here come the state troopers. They pulled up, and when they found out that all of us, you know, Randy Don and myself, we were all had just gotten out of the Army. Just about a year earlier. They said, "Well, boy, you can go out there and hitchhike on the highway, you know." I'm like, "Thanks, officer." That was the only two times. One time because we were vets, and the other time because he thought I was like an alien from outer space, you know. So, oh man, I was just glad. After that, I didn't have to hitchhike anymore. Eventually, I got the momentum going where I could take the Greyhound bus. So there I was, the one time in New York. I never bothered with that after that. Nothing. I barely had enough money to make it out of that city, you know. And totally ignored. It was like they actually were ensnared, and it was too easy. I hate to distill it down to that, because these are real people, you know. And I'm not looking down on them at all. But, you know, it's like, it can't be my problem because there's nothing I can do to help them. Oh, how would they receive help from me anyway? I'm just trying to contribute a little insight into the dilemma here. So, the dainty and the delicate ensnare the seeing blind. When confronted with the facts and truth, they just say, "Never mind." "No thanks," say they triumphantly. "Destruction's road they take. After all, it's called prosperity, with chaos in its wake." Ah, tell you, bud, real planet Earth, the real thing, man. There's this conflict between what's going on in human society and the way the whole universe functions. Look at the way things are functioning in space. Doesn't happen like that down here. You got this dingy little dank world of garbage mountains. Okay, I've talked enough. I'm out of here, bud. Out of here and out of money. See you all later.
A Tapestry of Then and Now, that was written in Brisbane, Australia, 1986. Along the slender passages of time-besplintered rope, of habits and of customs, we weave a thing called hope. And there the tapestry began to tell a lovely tale of men and women's bravery when love was not for sale. But now the friends, they overflow on the schooners of the rich, who brag about their poverty while others they bewitch to get a thing called cash flow from sorcerers of theft. More money for less product is what buys them their respect. Along the slender passages of time, splintered rope, of habits and of customs, we weave a thing called hope. And there the tapestry began to tell a lovely tale of men and women's bravery when love was not for sale. The dainty and the delicate are when it's snare of the blind. When asked if they would know the truth, they just say, "Never mind." "No thanks," say they triumphantly. Destruction's road they take. After all, it's called prosperity with chaos in its way.
It's time to change the steel. It's time to change the steel. We now have a greater flexibility in work with chemistry and the elements due to the advent of the computer in the laboratory. The basis of steel is iron, of course, which is much more than a metal. And because of that, its alloys don't have to be metal. The strength of industrial steel alloyed with other elements in great, extensive combinations. Sometimes with combinations of cataly that are in tension one with another. One could be seen as weak by itself, but extremely strong and durable when woven into certain geometric structures. Hence, a light material easily transported to the site, then woven in place by apparati, which I call spitters. For example, to produce an earthquake-proof building or a tunnel complex for an underground highway of fuel cell-powered vehicles. The sheer complexity and enormity of the combinations and the cataloging of the intricacies would tend to be an industry only the United States could excel in for many reasons, such as the enormity of the task, the extensiveness of the shipping coordination, and something often never noticed. The homogeneous nature of American society. Extreme undertakings suggest a division of labor only obtainable by a close to total as possible blend of human beings from genetic backgrounds of all sections of the planet in the presence of a climate of sufficiency. No group of human individuals has the genetic history to complete extreme tasks. Each group brings to the shop a certain set of inherited characteristics which can only work when in tandem with other characteristics of other groups. This is why the European society was able to enter the Industrial Revolution, and why the United States society was able to enter the computer age, because of the homogeneous society. Other geographic areas are catching up, but there is a drawback. It takes at least two or maybe three generations for a genetic grouping to recover from the cultural shock and other trauma of the new environment. Here's a tip for the new homogeneous societies, though. If you include stimuli from the old country, the inverted commas, quote unquote, the roots of their genetic past, it apparently helps. There are at least 2,000 or 3,000 variables of iron that can be immediately had that are heretofore unknown to mankind, such as alloys with iron in rocket fuel, iron and silicon in glass, iron and gold in combination with a few dozen cataly in conductors and spacecraft, iron and carbon fibers. Iron that is liquid at room temperature. Iron and alloys that form a power source by variable electrically stimulated shape memories. Iron in equipment that extracts gold from deep water geysers. You may find those variables to literally be infinite in number. This is the nature of elements. Each element has some sort of extreme characteristic. Can't they explain that by nucleus and electrons? There has to be something else going on here, something we haven't been able to really wrap our thought around yet. Now, that's an industry competitors could never match. Each of our elements in the earth is like a symphony. We as a people never got round to really appreciating it. That's right, we as a people never really got round to actually appreciating that, I suppose. Among these elements, it's humble ones like iron and carbon and oxygen, silicon that are major players. I was just thinking today, I was up on the roof looking at all that cement out there, huge mounds of this incredible element, calcium. Major players here. That's your problem with the steel industry right there. Too much business as usual and not enough enthusiasm. You have to romance the metal here. If you're going to prosper in a thing, you've got to get excited. I can foretell for you which industries are doomed to fail. Just look at the bland faces of the employees as they come to work. If there's no life in the industry, it is already history. Maybe forgotten history. The work ethic is not enough. An industry is destroyed by the mundane. Still, the ones who have operated the steel industry from the ground up, from the workers to the management, deserve respect. My grandfather worked in a steel mill. It's an awesome thing to work with the big metal. All metals are beautiful. Something even to touch them, a block of steel, a bit of iron, some titanium, aluminum, gold, silver, copper. It's time to get excited about it and get out there and see what else we can do with them. Or you can sit down, give up, and Dale will haunt you. You know, Dale Carnegie? The key to movement is diversity. It is the difference. It is the difference that gets exported to foreign markets. It's the exceptional that gets demanded. If you've just got more of the same, you won't even get noticed. Eventually. Use the same six-shooter, and someone faster will eventually come along. You'll never run out of iron. The asteroid belt is full of it. It's the punctuation of the stars.